like he said, yes, there is that donation basket. If you do get in donations, what I'm saving the money up to do is one day hopefully buy my own clavichord. They go up to about $3,000 at least for the better types that are used normally. Just because the instrument we're using today comes from Stony Brook University. Arthur Ross usually lets us borrow instruments for concerts. He's very lenient about that, and I appreciate it, but I know at one point in my life I won't have the university to borrow from all the time. So if you do donate, I appreciate it. If not, it's totally okay too. There's also business cards in the back. If you're interested, I'm going to be putting up recordings on my website or on my Facebook, which is PK Collins Music as well. And thank you. So as I was getting into Northanger Abbey, Jane Austen, and looking into what this particular story talks about, which is a lot of Gothic horror novels, I just decided to look up what exactly this genre is. And I had this reading from an article by Norma Salai called The Plight of the Gothic Heroine, Female Development and Relationships in the 18th Century Female Gothic Fiction. And it says, the conventional plot of Gothic fiction tends to digress at a crucial point depending on whether it was written by a male or female. In male writing, which is also read as a tale of seduction, it concludes either with the death of the heroine or with her being saved at the last moment. By female-written fiction, the heroine is much more independent and active, and she plays a significant role in releasing herself from her situation. Most Gothic novels are based on a woman being trapped in a castle and by the end escaping in some fashion. An interesting thing here is Catherine has been invited to go to Northanger Abbey with Henry, and while she's been reading this Udolpho novel, she's started to project these fantastical ideas onto her daily life. So she's in Northanger Abbey. She sees that Henry's mother is missing, and she determines on her own that the father had killed the mother. And she spends this part of the novel trying to prove that that had happened. It didn't. That is not the case at all. But she believes it, and it makes a comedy of errors for her. Basically showing her growing up, realizing that you can't apply fiction to all daily life. But I still find it interesting, and I tried to think about it more in a modern sense, like what do we still consider as Gothic fiction, and that's where these next two pieces come from. Cicio is from a theater piece, a Portuguese song, translated as Whispers. It takes place in an old castle spanning across a whole millennium, and the song is about a bittersweet love that doesn't end well, sort of like Gretchen on Spin Road. And the other piece, Precious Hewie, comes from a Gothic video game where a woman is trapped in a castle and she meets this dog, Hewie, like the piece says, and he helps her escape on her own. So the first piece is a song, and the second piece is a ground bass, which we often play in early music all the time. And it's based on four notes that just keep repeating over and over, and you just keep improvising over it. So these are the only modern type pieces in this concert, but I hope y'all knew it. Thank you. Going to do a reading about Catherine in the city. This really isn't a quote or anything, I'm just talking about her time in the city. Like I mentioned before, she has an ongoing romance option triangle thing between John Thorpe and Henry Tilney. And like I said before as well, she finds out she really doesn't like John, but she's trying to befriend him and because she's friends with Isabella, but she really does not find him fun to be around. And at the end of, I think like chapter 11, she goes, he's utterly disagreeable. But because she wants to be friends with these people, she continues being around them. She really wants to be with Henry because they met once very early on in the book. And they went to a dance and she really liked it, but she never got to see him again for a few days. So she kept going to all these dances hoping to run into him. But John kept finding her and asking her to dance with her. And it was very traditional back then, if a woman refuses one man to dance, she can't dance with anyone that night. So she just keeps dancing with this guy, trying to hopefully find Henry. She does eventually, but there's just many moments in there that she's just a little unhappy. But these last two pieces also come from Jane Austen's music library, Kinloch of Kinloch and the Royal Circus Rondo. One thing that Jane Austen really likes, and you'll see if you go through her music library, she loves popular songs that are written into variations, and then she loves rondos that come back to a theme, kind of like I did with Fairy Dance earlier. Kinloch specifically, it comes from John Walton's second collection of circus tunes in 1798. It was used as a march, a song, a jig, and a waltz. It was just used for anything. It was found in Britain, North America, and England and Ireland. And the second piece, Royal Circus Rondo, I'll talk about really quickly once I get to that piece. I hope you enjoy Kinloch of Kinloch. do the last piece. So like I said, this is part of an ongoing series I'm going to be working on. I'm trying to do a concert on each one of Jane Austen's novels. And the one I'm going to be working on next spring is focused on Pride and Prejudice. I'm looking not at Elizabeth Bennet, but the concert's going to be about Mary Bennet and her musical ways that most people do not appreciate because she's not very graceful as a performer. She focuses more on theory instead of the actual execution. And it kind of shows how people are not very impressed with her sometimes. And that one will be on harpsichord and clavichord. I'm trying to use all keyboard instruments as I can. So this last piece is called, I call it the Royal Circus Rondo, because one problem with looking through this library is sometimes the text and everything is very pixelated and I can't really read it. So the best that I can figure from this is called the Rondo Danced by Miss Adams with Great Applause in the Rival States Performed at the Royal Circus. Composed and arranged for the pianoforte by James Sanderson. Again, another rondo where you have a theme that keeps coming back over and over. And it was a piece that people danced to back then, and it was danced at a circus of some sort. So I hope you enjoy it.
Ladies and gentlemen, and I think that we've had a very good introduction, not only to the music of Jane Austen, but also to a new instrument that I thought was kind of a side step relative to the harpsichord, but I find out now that it's probably very much of its own in the tone and such, and I really appreciated the chance to really hear it under the close and upfront circumstances. I mean, I have one question in our period. You talked before about acquiring your own instrument. Is that something you have to order ahead of time and wait to be built, or is it there? Are there floor models that you want to try out?
Yeah, that would be much more expensive. Harpsichord Clearinghouse sells clavichords as well as harpsichords.
Yeah.
They do that every 2 years in Boston. I mean, they sell them all the time. But that's
where there is an active market then at that point for.
Yes, there is. But at the same time, it's just there's not much need for more than one.
Okay.
I mean, harpsichord, you can get different country versions, and so we have it at Stony Brook, French, German, Italian, Flemish. We try to get the repertoire range. But with clavichords, I've only seen like one per university get that. And it's really a hit or miss if the instrument's even working, because Texas has one. Texas has two, and they're both broken. Baylor, where I teach at in Texas, has one, but it's also broken. And people just, if no one's playing it, there's no need to fix it in their minds. And I understand that. It's a shame, too.
Well, what is your schedule now on performances? Do you have, are you in the field, or do you schedule out? What do you perform, just on the harpsichord, or a combination of both instruments when you have a performance?
I can play anything, as long as it's fine. I mean, I play mostly on harpsichord, because that's where most of the accompanying gigs are. But I still play on clavichord, too. I did this concert back in September, as well. And I still play with piano, accompanying vocalists, instruments. So, I got to keep all the skills up because it makes money.
Any questions on the floor relative to the instrument, to the composition, or what?
Did I understand correctly, Kyle, that the clavichord years ago was like people would be kind of judged worthy, or the clavichord they would play first before they moved on to the piano?
C.P. Bach in his treatise, he recommends starting on a clavichord, and Gottlieb Turk also. They both think if you can start on a clavichord, if you can play this instrument well, you'll be able to play the other instruments well. But it doesn't work in the reverse, and I can attest to that because I started on piano and then harpsichord, and I spent last year trying to play this, and I'm still having a lot of trouble. It's just...
So it's a much more demanding instrument to play.
It is. It doesn't sound like it, but it is, yeah.
So given that it's more difficult to play, what was it that attracted you to it?
I love the sound of it. I also love quieter spaces and smaller settings. I mean, the instrument, it's very pretty, especially with vocal music, more than the harpsichord. And it's a different tone from the piano. There's a quote by someone that I cannot remember, but when I had done my lecture on this instrument, they said the clavichord is the window to the harp's soul and the harp's soundboard, which is a beautiful phrasing for the 18th century. And it's weird, a lot of writings that I find on the clavichord, they don't really talk about the mechanics of it, more just poetic, waxing poetic thoughts about it, which I find interesting, and I do agree with. I love the sound, and it's something I can play much longer than the other two instruments. I don't know why, just, I like the sound, but that's about what it was down to for me.
Music that came from the Austen Library, was that specifically composed for them, or is it just a collection of what was contemporary music?
Yeah, it's not just Jane Austen. All of her family was just collecting music and putting it into a folder. Jane Austen, there are two files on there, I think Jenkyns 2 and 3, where Jane Austen wrote these pieces out by hand, and it's a little hard to read, partly because of the internet quality, but all of her family was gathering music for harp, piano, harpsichord, voice especially, and some vocal duets that they sing with each other, I presume, for fun. But most of it is music that they bought and then just, they didn't sample it, but you know, they put all the music together.
So your comment suggests that the clavichord is compatible with voice presentations.
I don't know if it depends on the vocalist. It's a very quiet instrument, like y'all sing. The clavichord can work with a Brook flute because the flute is also one of the quietest period instruments, and I have done that before. It still takes some effort, but clavichord doesn't work as well in ensemble settings just because of how quiet it is.
Obviously. Are all the keyboards the same size, the number of notes? Standardized?
So this is 5 octaves, and in the 18th century, late 18th century, 5 octaves tended to be the norm. We start to build more as, you know, Beethoven and Chopin, they start composing larger music. But this is set like late 18th century, we've got 5 octaves generally.
Anyone else? Yes.
You described this being hard to play the piano. In what way?
Partly just because approaching the key, I'm not saying piano is easy at all, but whenever you press the key on the piano, it's more of an option of like, how is your attack in and how loud did you want that to sound? You can press this key just as you would, but you get this sound, just a chucking sound that will just, it'll interrupt what you're trying to do. So you have to be able to press each key with enough force, but not too much force that you change the note. So like here it's the F, you you have to press it just enough that the sound still happens. But if I press like, just like that, and it did happen a few times tonight. yeah, it's enough. It's a balance between making it sound out at the dynamic you want without that. Even that was soft. It's a process. I'm still working on it.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Yes, Dan.
Kyle, you mentioned that you teach at Baylor.
Yes.
And obviously, you've got a connection at Stony Brook, and you live in Setauka. Can you kind of connect the dots of all those locations?
I mean, I've been teaching at Baylor University since before I moved up here. So about 4 years now, because I used to study in Texas up until I moved up here. So I still fly down to Texas twice a month to teach harpsichord and forte piano to students there. And then I go to school here.
And what was it that drew you to Stony Brook?
Arthur Haas is a great teacher, for one, and I saw that the program was very open to different programming ideas, because programs like this wouldn't normally work in a school setting, but Arthur Haas has been very accepting of trying out these ideas. Also, we have a clavichord here that I've never had in a university before. Basically, Stony Brook just had a lot of gig options, and I think that's really important for a student, you know, just to figure out what you want to do. So, I've been happy.
When you go to Baylor, how many in your course sign up?
4 to 6. This semester I've got 4. So it's a secondary program there. They don't have a harpsichord major.
Is it theory or is it performance, actually?
All performance.
All performance.
Oh, well, my students are pedagogy, theory, and performance. It's just usually a graduate student, but it depends. Mm. It just depends on who's there. I've got one student that wants to major in harpsichord next year, so I'm happy that people, at least the teaching's working there.
Congratulations.
I'm excited. Thank you.
Anyone else? All right. Well, thank you again. I think it's an outstanding evening. Thank you.